I want to show you this diagram. Basically, it illustrates what I mean by the annual motion of stars related to the Earth's revolution around the Sun. Okay? So, for instance, at the beginning of the year, January 1, the constellation that is kind of overhead in the midnight sky, right? This, on this side of the Earth that is not illuminated by the Sun, it's midnight, it would be Gemini, right? But then March the 1st, 2 months later, the constellation directly overhead would be Leo. And Gemini would fall behind, okay? So it looks to us as if, in addition to this daily motion of the stars related, which is much quicker, 15 degrees per hour, that there is another one that we start seeing over the period of a few weeks, which is related to this motion of the Earth around the Sun. And as a result of this motion, the stars and the constellation move across the sky, but at much slower rate, at roughly 1 degree per day. Now, to describe the motions of stars and the Sun, we use the concept of celestial sphere. So this gives or illustrates the concept of celestial sphere. It is an imaginary sphere of radius much, much bigger than the radius of the Earth that is centered on Earth. In a way, it kind of is related to what one sees or has impression of seeing when you look at the night sky, in particular when you are located somewhere on the flat grounds, say on the field, or you are on the boat in the middle of the lake, right? There are no other objects. It looks to us that as if there is a dome on top of us, and as if the stars are pinned to that dome, right? And that dome that we perceive is effectively this celestial sphere. Here is the North Pole, and on the opposite side, there is a South Pole. So the Earth's spin axis runs north-south. Now, if I would extend this rotational axis of the Earth all the way out to the celestial sphere, it would puncture it at two points, one here directly above the Earth's North Pole, and that point is called North Celestial Pole. On the opposite side, the point that is directly above the Earth's South Pole is called South Celestial Pole. And we know that right now, or for a few thousand years around the time in which we live, there is a star close to it. And that star is Polaris. As it happens, there is no star that is close to the South Celestial Pole in the Southern Hemisphere. Nevertheless, one can use a constellation called the Southern Cross and its motion to actually pinpoint the location of the South Celestial Pole. But as it happens right now, there is no star sitting close to the South Celestial Pole. Okay, now this line on celestial sphere that is directly above the Earth's equator, it's called celestial equator. So you can get celestial equator by extending the Earth's equatorial plane all the way out to celestial sphere, and the line along which the equatorial plane of the Earth cuts the celestial sphere, that is the celestial equator. So it's a line on celestial sphere directly above the Earth's equator. Now, each observer has a horizon. This would be horizon for this particular observer, who apparently here is roughly at our latitude, halfway between North Pole and the equator. So this is his horizon. And if one would extend the observer's horizon all the way out so that the plane cuts the celestial sphere, it would cut it along the circle that is called celestial horizon. Now, keep in mind that the Earth is spinning around this north-south axis from west to east. And appears to us, because of that, that the stars are actually spinning in the opposite direction, from east to west. Moreover, their trajectories across the celestial sphere are always parallel to the celestial equator. And the reason is simply because celestial equator is perpendicular to the Earth's north-south axis, because the equatorial plane of the Earth is perpendicular to this north-south axis. So, and the apparent motion of the stars, the daily motion of the stars, is going to take place along the lines that are parallel to celestial equator.